Well, hello and welcome everyone. The topic of today is creative leadership. What it is, where it came from, and what each and every one of us can do to enact and enable its values in our lives, families, working business, and self-development. My name is Ninella. I have been part of the creative leadership team for the last 3 years alongside Director Ramagi Ravo and colleagues on the research and diverse applications of our model. This model is based on the three values of empathy, clarity, and creativity. And today we will hear from Rama himself about what they are and the beginnings of creative leadership. Rama will be interviewed by Dr. Melanie Flory, psychologist, neuroscientist, and founding director of MindRio, a consultancy intersecting neuroscience, design, and systems thinking to develop people-centered business and cultural architecture for organizations in change. Melanie has been neuroscience partner of the creative leadership research since 2018, looking at building a spectrum of emotional, cognitive, and behavioral aspects of the creative leadership values. We could think of no one better to help unpick Rama's story, brain, and wisdom. We have two guests with us today, Irene Mbari-Kirika, founder and executive director of Enable, Christopher Patno, head of accessibility and disability inclusion at Google. They will each give a short presentation after the interview. This will be followed by an introduction on the Creative Leaders Circle, where my colleague Evelina Gajeva will tell us how to participate. We will have time for the Q&A at the end, but please do keep the questions coming in as they arise. And a few brief housekeeping items before we kick off. We are in webinar mode, which means we can't see you, but we look forward to seeing your questions. Post them in the Q&A box. You can also like a question if that resonates with you. It helps us stay on track of what is important. Should you experience any technical issues, we have the chat box for that, and my colleagues are on standby to help. Captions are available, which you can enable from the bottom right-hand corner of your screens. And finally, we are recording this session and it will be available in a few weeks' time on our website. Without further ado, I would like to hand over to Melanie Flory, who will lead the next part of today's session.
Thank you, Ninella. To unprick Rama's brain and wisdom, how long have we got? It's a tall order. Hello, everyone. My name is Melanie Flory. It's a total understatement when I say I've been looking forward to interviewing Rama Girawa, director of the Helen Hamlyn Centre and of Design at the Royal College of Art. Today, I'll be talking to Rama about the story of creative leadership. This interview is about Rama, the person and the founder of creative leadership. It's about the foundational beginnings and evolutionary journey of creative leadership. It's about Rama's vision for creative leadership. It's about the team that supports Rama in taking creative leadership into the workplace, touching the lives of people, creatively reconstructing leadership to be effective, inclusive, and responsive to the complexities, trends, and fluctuations of the world we live in. Rama joined the Helen Hamlyn Center in 1999 at its very inception, and was appointed director in October 2015. Happy fifth anniversary, Rama. He has worked through the whole gamut of design and research roles that he now directs. Rama has, therefore, the lived experience to steer the center to fulfill the call for inclusive design and empathic leadership, which has become an even more pressing global need since the onset of the COVID pandemic. Rama founded Creative Leadership in 2007. To date, Creative Leadership Executive Education and Workshops have been attended by over 5,000 people worldwide. This outreach provides rich ground for testing user experience and receptivity of its core values and applications across a worldwide diverse demographic. Our personal life stories go a very long way in shaping the professionals we become. Today, I want to speak directly to Rama, the person who wears the hat of director of the center and founder of creative leadership. Without further ado, let's begin. Rama, let me take you back to the 1st of January this year, a new year, a time for celebrating and wishing well. For you and your family, it was a personal watershed. Your dear dad passed away. In our brief conversations, I've had glimpses of the profound effect this has had on you and your professional life. Would you share a little bit about this with us?
So, absolutely, Melanie. I'm very honored by the introduction. I hardly recognize myself. And I know we want to start off at an incredibly personal level because creative leadership is an incredibly personal thing. It's not the three values of creative leadership: empathy, clarity, and creativity. They're not learnt, they are lived and they are living. And I would never ask anyone to do something I wouldn't do myself. And we ask people every day to share of themselves the best and the worst, the best times and the worst times, the positives and the negatives. So that's what we are doing here. There was that time, the 1st of January, when the world erupted in celebration at 11:47 p.m. the night before the 31st of December, we got the phone call and we were driving to the care home to say goodbye. It was also a difficult time for me personally and professionally around health, around work and personal life. And as we were able to spend 6 hours and say goodbye to my dad, these three values really reverberated even more within me. A question came to me of dark and light, that we always talk about the light, but only the dark fully helps you appreciate the light. And maybe at that point, which was physically dark and mentally dark in my life, where is the light? And I think one of the things that came out came out of this for me was a question about the purpose of life. So if you'll indulge me for just another minute, I wanted to talk a little bit about that. When we think of creative leadership, those three values spoke to me personally at that time. And in my dad's eulogy, there was some reflection of them because I asked what was the purpose of his life and what purpose, conversely, do I give to my life? So I wanted to read a little bit of the eulogy, and it speaks to empathy, creativity, and clarity. So I asked, what is the purpose? And the answer that came through the pen was this: you were born to give as well as receive and find beauty in the balance between the two. And for me, that's empathy. It's that balance of giving and receiving. You were born to find freedoms in the most unlikely places in the world and learn the most difficult lessons from the most unexpected people and cherish that. And that is creativity. And those of us who are designers know that all too well. You were born to find grace in the darkest corners of your life and shine a light so bright that it burns any negativity around you. And that for me was the strongest statement, the one of clarity, that you were born to find grace in the darkest corners of your life. And this is what creative leadership is. It's just a bridge. It's a transformational process. We all go through dark times, but I hope that empathy, clarity, and creativity can provide it, a scaffolding, a journey. It's not a destination, but it is a lived and living process.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Rama, because you've really brought home to us that creative leadership is all encompassing, and it forms a very, what you've just said actually forms a very integrous aligned thread through some of the conversations we've had, in which the person is, you can't compartmentalize people. Yes, we have different aspects of life, work life, you know, home life, but we're one person. I'd like to move on a little to creative leadership itself. Why creative leadership? Why not empathic leadership, for example? And why these very specific three values of empathy, clarity, and creativity? And with my work with you, their intersection is magic. I'm sorry to you as a scientist to use that word, but can you actually speak into that space?
Absolutely. Creative leadership is a name, but it's not a name that we are tied to. One question that came was, how do you boil down all of these strategies and processes that are out there for self-development or for leadership or for organizational change? You know, how do you boil them down into the simplicity of a few words? And those three words came out. You know, creativity, I always joke, came from me as a designer. Empathy came through as a human being. And clarity came from an ex-girlfriend. And, you know, a relationship that was entirely unclear what happened at the end of it. But when you look at some of these kind of esoteric, mystical, even magical, to use your word, look at some of these terms. How do you bring them into a business context? How do you bring them to the level of PowerPoint or Zoom? And in the early days, we were talking of design leadership, personal leadership, transformational leadership. And it hit me one day that we are creatives, we are designers. It was born from inclusive design, from the empathic values and inclusion that inclusive design lives. And that was a moment when, in front of a group of civil servants in Hong Kong, I said to them, hands up who wants to be more creative, and all of them put their hands up. Hands up who wants to be a better leader, especially a leader of yourself, because that's where it starts. All of them put their hands up. I said, who wants to be a designer? No one put their hands up. So creative leadership was born.
That's an absolutely wonderful story, but so like who you are, in that the authenticity of coming across creative leadership in this way, through a tried and tested lived experience, rather than contriving something. And I think this is what speaks. When we first met in 2018, I met you in April 2018, and in June, I interviewed you because I was assessing how neuroscience could support and advance creative leadership to make a difference in the right direction in terms of leadership generally. I'd like to comment on something you said to me at that interview, and I quote you, creative leadership is not about the maximum number of ideas per cubic meter per minute. It's a source of energy for transformation. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Sure, I knew my words would come back to bite me in a good way. The energy of transformation. Energy is an important component. You need to have a certain energy as a leader. And as you quoted me, Mel, I'm going to quote something back to you that you said to me just after that conversation. You know, you were talking about where does creativity, clarity, and empathy come from? Because they have a universality about them. And truly, they didn't come from my own brain. They came, or my own ego. They were a lived and living experience. And one of the things you said is they actually map on to the three of the four types of yoga. You know, and yoga is seen as pretty universal, pretty, it's very human facing. It's for people, it's about life, it's complete. You know, it's about union. And the four types of yoga are jnana, knowledge or clarity, bhakti, devotion or empathy, and then karma, action, creativity, which sort of maps onto head, heart, hand. The fourth type is energy. And I think with that statement, it was really talking about when you have these three in a balance, in a harmony, and a balance is an ever-moving thing. You know, a plane shouldn't fly. It's really heavy. But it, when it's up in the on the ground, it's a lumbering giant. In the sky, it's a weightless bird. And it's in the air, it's doing 1,000 micro adjustments every second. And that's balance, but it's balance. And a bumblebee shouldn't fly. If you look at that thing, it shouldn't fly. But a bumblebee flying is a beautiful thing. It's in balance. So that's really where this energy of transformation comes from.
Actually, you hijacked my next question, but what I'll do is to raise that question. Now that you've given me the introduction, that saves me. So the question was that that philosophy of mind, unlike other leadership models, the mastery of self-knowledge in leadership is something that seems to be that is forced on people, or that is possible. It's not forced, it's possible through creative leadership. Empathy requires self-mastery. Creativity, yes, you can get, inspiration from outside, but it comes from within. So this self-knowledge. And that came to me again through something you said in 2018. And I'd like you again to talk into that space again, because I think it's a wonderful share. You said creative leadership is not about creating better human beings. It's about giving people access to some of the most powerful parts of themselves.
It's exactly that. It's about giving your soul some space. It's about recognizing that most of what most of us are taught about leadership is wrong. It's recognizing that when we use the word leadership, and I wonder if we even need to change the word leadership, we don't actually mean someone who's standing at a podium projecting power. We don't mean the most tall, the most male, the most majority culture person in the room. Leadership starts with yourself. Every journey starts from within. And there's a couple of anomalies, such as we expect organizational change, but we don't look at how do we support or evolve individuals. And it's not about changing people. It's about bringing them, giving them the tools to discover the highest version of themselves, to stand in their own truth and in their own power. It's about the opposite of shouting. You know, life whispers its wisdoms. It doesn't shout them. And our greatest power comes to us when we're most quiet. And that was something that was at the heart of creative leadership. And I think, you know, very simply put, it's a strategy for, I once wrote this something about love where I said, you know, love is an open hand, it's not a closed fist. And that is creative leadership. You know, most of us are doing this. It's stress. It's holding on to job, or we should have got that promotion, or holding on to the negative things we were told in the past. And creative leadership is just this. And I realized that during lockdown, where I was off social media, I was healing, I was internalizing a lot, and I was in my greenhouse fiddling around with tomatoes. And I just had my hand open for some reason, and this butterfly came and gently landed on it. And I must have had some pollen or nectar or something, because it stayed there for a minute. And then when it had finished, it went off. And I just thought, that is the metaphor for what we want with the Creative Leader Circle. It's for people to land, make it their own, and be that most vibrant and visible version of yourself. Not loud, not type A personality, not extravagant or necessarily extrovert, but it's, you know, power is a quiet thing. It's actually, true power is love. So I'll just end with I'm known for quoting Tagore, but to answer that question, one of the things he says is a very small poem where he describes the difference between power and love or empathy. And it's this: power said to the world, "You are mine," and she imprisoned him on her throne. Love said to the world, "I am yours," and she gave him the freedom of her house. And that's what creative leadership aims to do. It's that.
Rama, that's so well said, that knowledge, you know, can be shouted from a podium, but wisdom is a whisper underneath that shouting. Ninella has just warned me that we're almost coming to a close. So I'm going to skip a few questions and ask you, what is the way forward? What is your vision for creative leadership over the next 5 years?
It's a very simple one. Creative leadership and the Creative Leader Circle is for three types of people. I think it's for one type of person, and that's, you know, if you're human, you know. I have run workshops where I've said, hands up if you're human, and some people don't put their hands up. I think they may not have heard the question, but it's for three types of people, bearing in mind that our definition of leader is probably more human than the traditional podium form of leadership. And it's for established leaders who can make the changes right now. It's for emerging leaders who will support change and make change and progress. But more importantly, it's for people who were never built to be leaders, never expected to be leaders. And that includes me. So that third group, I think, is the absolute, it's the people we are absolutely talking to. And just to end with one sentence, the core vision is this: there's so many things in the world that are imbalanced, you know, or where people are excluded, whether the environment is an imbalance, society, the economy, we're imbalanced by gender or race, as we've seen this year. And the pandemic has just brought these fractures. It's really emphasized them. So my humble hope, wish, and prayer is that if there's a space in the universe for creative leadership to fill, that it finds the people to do that, and that we bring the imbalance of the world back into balance.
Thank you so much, Rama. Although I haven't looked at the chat box, I suspect we will need to continue this conversation. Rama, thank you so much for your open sharing. I have no doubt that our audience is inspired and have gained many insights into the value and need for creative leadership. Audience, thank you for listening. Do post your questions. They're invaluable in us continuing this conversation. I'll now hand over to Ninella. Thank you, Ninella.
And thank you, Melanie, and thank you, Rama. Even though I've known you both for years, I always learn new things when you two speak and when you interact with each other. We have invited two friends and collaborators of the center to share their personal stories and insights on the topic of today, leadership. Each of them will have 5 minutes. The first one is Irene Mbarikirika, who founded Enable in 2008. 9 and is executive director now. Enable empowers blind and visually impaired students in Africa through technology and is a leader in inclusive education and assistive technology research. Irene's leadership improves the lives of marginalized youth in Africa, notably through her recent venture, TechnoPrize Consulting. She holds a Global Master's of Arts in International Affairs, and in 2016, Irene was awarded the Order of the Grand Warrior of Kenya by its government. Wow, it's a real honor to have you with us here today, Irene. Over to you.
Thank you, Ninela. So on the topic of creative leadership, I think it's an extremely, extremely interesting topic. And I like the fact that it's not too formal to what businesses view leadership as. So I will walk down the path of maybe explaining empathy, clarity, and creativity, what really those words mean to me based on my experience. And I agree with Rama. I think Rama says that empathy is a must-have quality for every leader. And I say that empathy is everything in a good leader because this allows you to connect with people and real life. In my situation, I met blind kids very unexpectedly. And just out of interacting with them, I realized these kids are brilliant, they're competitive. Despite the fact that they are blind, they don't even notice they're blind. But I realized they had to share braille books, they graduate with braille skills, and I realized that they don't even get into employment. So for me, I was able to directly connect with these kids. And I realized that empathy allows you to actually see what other people don't see. I was able to see these children in a very different light. And the fact that I had no clue, I had no idea what blindness is about. I was able to go out and really try and figure out what is the solution. So that's sort of how Enable was born. It's just out of curiosity and being able to really connect with blind and visually impaired children. I must say it's been a journey. It's been a roller coaster. It's been very a very, very humbling experience. And when I think about clarity, what I can say first off is that clarity takes time. I think for me, it took a very long time, and I'm basing it on Enable. And part of it is because of the type of program we were leading is that we are trying to train blind youth to use technology and get into employment. But you're dealing in an environment where people don't believe blind people actually use technology. At the same time, local organizations can't really understand the whole concept. And then international organizations that totally champion disability in other parts of the world, when they come to Africa, they don't do the same. So it was a very difficult environment because it's like you're trying something so new and people are like, how does this happen? So for me, I think with time, it's taken us almost 14 years to actually have a voice. 14 years for people to understand that tech is very, very important to people with disabilities. So for me, I think through my journey, what gave me more clarity is having to come to terms with a few things. For example, I had to come to terms with the fact that I'm very passionate about this project. The blind and low vision students are truly competitive, brilliant, and they truly deserve an equal chance in life. But it does not mean that the rest of the world agrees with me or sees what I see. This was a very critical part of me because it helped me deal with the issue of lack of investment in the space. And it also allowed me to be able to start appreciating the compliments and the praises that we were receiving from individuals here and there, just saying, you guys are doing a fantastic job. So we were able to receive that. And for me, it was also important to understand that it's okay not to know when investments in this space are finally going to come, because it came to a situation where we realized we don't know where to go. But I realized with being okay with that situation, it helped us get into a moment where we can start thinking, what do we do next? So when I think about creativity, clarity, I think about some of the experiences we've had in life. And I think I gained my clarity mainly through prayer and meditation. Those are very, very important to me. And I think more of silence, and more silence really helps build us when we are thinking about getting clarity on different issues in life. On the last piece, which is creativity, I think I actually like the sequence. When you have some clarity, you're able to be creative, because part of it, I think, just realizing that we don't know when this will happen and it's okay. Then it was easy for us to really start figuring out, how do we survive, especially with limited resources? How do we keep these programs going until when the world actually realizes that tech is very important for people with disabilities in Africa? So for me as a leader, people don't realize leadership is a very lonely journey, because you question, you reflect on everything you're going through. As everybody else, as your teams are doing everything, you have to think, you have to reflect, you have to take time, be quiet, figure things out. Sometimes you're right, sometimes you're wrong. But I think what helps is that with what you come up with and what your teams comes up with, then you're able to come up with very creative ways of surviving. So for me, when I look at creativity, I think of it as a team effort, and I think of it as part of our everyday experiences. And that's why it's important to know that everyone has some form of creativity. Actually, I didn't realize I was a creative until 2 years ago, when I was sitting with a friend and we were having a conversation about all the stuff I'm doing. And he turned around and said, "Irene, you're such a creative. Do you realize that?" But I had no clue. But since then, I've been able to sort of wear that hat and realize that based on your life experiences, open your heart and keep creative, keep communicating, because it does affect the teams that you deal with. And sort of that's how I carry on with life. And I'll say, when it comes to creativity, empathy, and clarity, I think they are very, very critical to any leader that we have today. Thank you.
Thank you, Irene. I love every single word of what you said, particularly when you said when you have clarity, you are able to be creative. And that goes to show that even when we have limited resources, actually the intellectual, the internal creativity is all at our disposal. Our next presenter is Christopher Patno. He's head of accessibility programs and diversity inclusion at Google, where he leads their efforts around accessibility of product, people, and partnerships. He has more than 20 years of experience in tech, working at companies like Apple, Sony, Ericsson, and Disney, where he's built hardware, software, and services. His passion is accessibility, immersive technologies, and consumer hardware. He chairs the Immersive Captions Community Group at W3C and is a trustee for the American Foundation for the Blind. Christopher, you always have a unique way of building on the ideas that we share in our exchange. And so I look forward to hearing your presentation today. Over to you.
Thank you, Nina, and thank you, Rama, for the opportunity to participate. And I mean, it's always frightening to have to follow you in any kind of conversation. You're so inspiring. But coming to the topic of the day, the Buddha once said that a Brahmin is born a Brahmin, and in the same way a teacher teaches and a farmer farms. So bringing this to today, this means that a manager manages, but unfortunately, anyone can be a manager with the stroke of a pen or the sending of an email. But this also means that a leader leads. Since a leader is followed, no matter what you see in social or professional media, no one can truthfully just call themselves a leader. This became clear to me when a colleague followed me to a team in accessibility, not because they had any affinity towards accessibility, but because he wanted to work for me again. And that's when this sort of became clear to me. So then the interesting question is, how do you get people to follow you as a leader, especially in the creative, digital, and connected world? And to me, the answer comes with the concept here of creative leadership: empathy, clarity, and creativity. They need to be there, and they need to be balanced. If you lean too much in one or deficient, you will either lose your way or you could hurt others along the way. So I want to share three examples of leaders that I've experienced where clarity, empathy, and creativity are or are not in balance. I'm going to obfuscate the names, but you might be able to realize who they are. The first person is a person with initials of SJ. SJ, to me, is a man with selective empathy, but laser-like clarity and boundless creativity. He showed a huge amount of empathy for the consumer and their needs, but not really empathy for the people around him, and didn't often care about the way that he came across. And to this, there was mixed results. the pressure brought out the best in some people and caused misery for others. For the creation of one of his greatest products, there's a documentary, and it's unclear how many divorces happened from the creation of this product. And I have a personal experience with this. I ended up getting divorced myself by going too deep into a project, which is sort of the culture in this company. Heck, at one point, my son called the phone daddy because I would be at work at late and I would call to say goodnight to him. And my wife at the time would say, "It's daddy." And he started calling the phone daddy. That's not a great feeling. Well, people followed SJ, but so many people feared him that I literally left an elevator when he walked in because I was afraid he would ask a question and I get the answer wrong. He would be utterly brutal in his feedback. And unfortunately, too many people took that lesson of SJ. And this leads to my next leader example. This is BD. BD is a person who showed little empathy, little clarity, but he was successful because of good business acumen and little creativity. And this is the person who took the SJ a-hole pill. He had little empathy and an understanding of how he came across. This person literally fired a studio head in Europe. We're in California, but it did it on the phone in the middle of an open office landscape in front of the team. This is not a great way to get the team to embrace you. Also, he had not a lot of clarity. An example here is one day he decided we wanted to build a word game because at the time word games was all the rage. So we spent several weeks working on word games, and actually I created an idea, submitted it, and my idea won. But 2 days after he decided this was the game we wanted to do, he said, sorry, word games are passe. No one wants to do word games anymore. So here's a person who's struggling to find what the right thing was to do. Fortunately, I got a game mechanic patent out of it, but I never got my game. In terms of creativity, this may seem funny for someone who makes games, but he was a businessman who thought himself a creative genius. He surrounded himself by creative people and took credit for their work. This also leads into the empathy. So here's a person who was successful almost by accident or out of good business acumen in a creative space, but that doesn't make him a creative leader. But some people do get this right. This person I'll call SP. This is a leader to me who has them all in balance. People listen to him and he listens to people. People respect his direction, but also respect him enough to push back if they disagree, and he listens to that as well. He's also creative enough to come up with things as radical as the Chrome browser when Microsoft owned everything and Chrome OS. Fortunately for me, and I know he's not listening, so I'm not blowing smoke, he's the CEO of Google. His name is Sundar Pichai, and he's someone that I've learned to respect. My takeaway here is, with these in mind, is if one is a servant leader, if one has a healthy balance of empathy, creativity, and clarity, it will be much easier for people to be willing to follow you, no matter where you go. This is a journey that we're all on, and we're more interconnected than you may realize. With some self-awareness, you can understand the aspects of empathy, creativity, and clarity, and learn how to keep them in balance. How you keep it in balance is up to you, be it meditation, yoga, exercise, qigong, listening to or making music. You know what it is that makes you centered. You know what it is that gets you into your flow. Know that you have the answer and do whatever you need to listen to that quiet voice inside that guides you. Thank you.
Thank you, Christopher. And thank you, Irene, Rama, and Melanie for the insightful contributions. And now onto the Creative Leaders Circle. What is it? It's a coming together of diverse people, groups, and organizations from all over the world to envisage, enact, and enable new models and pathways for global leadership. For us, creative leadership is not just a strategy, and you have heard from Rama, or an abstract concept. It's a transformational process for everyone to contribute, participate, and apply in their life and work. It's truly inclusive. And at the center, we conduct formal research, but the Creative Leaders Circle reaches out and invites you all to share in this, to contribute and evolve a common global understanding of what leadership should be and the actions we individually can take to enact this. Unlike our model, which was born from Rama, his mind and lived experience, This platform was created in direct response to a call that came from you, our audience. People who came to our workshops, resonated with our articles and presentations. How do I get involved? Can I contribute? How can I help, you asked. And so this is our response to you. And I would like to thank one person in particular, Gabrielle Abornos, a UX designer who came to our Creative Leadership Masterclass in November last year. And he was a catalyst behind the creation of this platform. So how to engage? On our website, you will find two ways to immediately engage with us. One is a manifesto for leadership today, which we're wanting to co-create with people from all over the world. And you can directly register for this event. My colleague Evelina will tell you how. The second is a growing community of shared intent, which you can join as early as today. We all need support and we all need friends. And so this creates that for all of us. And I will now hand you over to my colleague Evelina, who will walk us through the website and ways to join. Evelina Oiva is a long-term friend of the center and has supported this work from the start. She's an inclusive designer through and through and brings empathy and joy to our team and the events we run. Over to you, Eva.
Thank you very much, Nelly. Just a moment, I'll share my screen with you. This is our webpage address, and now I will walk you through this. First page welcomes everyone and gives brief information about the platform itself. You can sign up and stay up to date with our future events and latest activities. Further down on our homepage, there is a further information about creative leadership concept and model. And on the left, there is an image of the model. And on the right, there is more information about the concept. Bottom down, there is a link included to our RCA page with details about the research and the application of the model. Back to our homepage, there is a video on the topic, and also it is indicated one of the main ways, as Nelly just mentioned, joining our manifesto. And this is actually going to be our very first event where we will co-create a manifesto for creative leadership with people from all around the world, which is actually means all of you. There is an information here about the event itself. And also we decided to do two sessions, one in the morning and one in the evening. So to be more convenient to different time zones and where people are joining from. You can also join our creative leader circle community. And here are people sharing their thoughts on leadership today and answering on our three brief questions, which you can also find under this section on our webpage here. And please feel free to send us your responses in a format which is the most convenient to you. It could be a short video, a voice recording, a picture, image, wherever. We are really excited and curious to hear from you. And now back to you, Nelly.
Thank you, Eva. That concludes. So if there are any further questions about the Creative Leader Circle, my colleagues have already shared the links with you in the chat, but also feel free to reach out directly on our email, hacd@rca.ac.uk. This concludes the presentation portion for today. I can see the questions flooding the Q&A, but before I kick off, I would like to ask you, the audience, one question. And if we can start the first poll, We talked a lot about empathy in leadership today. How often do you notice or experience the practice of empathy in leadership? Wow, it's amazing to see these answers moving and the percentage is growing. I have to tell you, the first person who answered said often, so I would like to know who they are and what they are experiencing. Fantastic. Oh, thank you. That was Helen Simmons. It's wonderful. So I will end the poll now and we can share the results. Half of you experience the empathy in leadership sometimes. So I think this is wonderful to see. And I hope that following on from today's conversations, we will begin to notice and express and enact more and more acts of empathy in our own leadership and find that in others. And if I could ask all the panelists to join me on screen, we will kick off with the Q&A for today. Fantastic. So I'd like to kick off with the first question, which is from Helen Simmons to all panelists. She would like to know more about quiet leadership and how to succeed with a creative leadership style that is focusing on the qualitative successes in an organization which measures quantitative achievements. Rama, would you like to address this one first?
I was just about to pass the buck to Melanie. I'll say something very, very briefly, because there's another question from a person called Lucy that I wanted to answer. but I think within the world, we put a lot of emphasis on numbers, on statistics, on the kind of qualitative data, but stats are just numerical opinion. They're important numerical opinion. And to keep the answer short, if design firms, design agencies, and design organizations can measure creativity using a whole host of different tools, I would hope that we're able to put our faith into qualitative measures as well. So a very quick example of this is we were doing a workshop, we were doing a project which looked at supermarket packaging, and the marketing manager said 80 something percent of our customers don't have a problem, which is a stat. We went out and filmed 6 80-year-olds having problems. And it was a very qualitative thing. You know, one guy called Frank spent 12 minutes trying to open Easy Peel bacon packaging. And that persuaded them that there was an issue that we needed to do a project. Simple answer.
Thank you, Rama. And Christopher, I wondered whether there may be something you wanted to add to this one. I remember in our last conversation, when we visited you at Google, we talked about measuring value within a technology company.
Yeah, this is something that we struggle with, frankly, when it comes to accessibility, because when you talk about the people with disabilities in any given segment of society, it tends to be a smaller number of people impacted. So we try to have a balance of both qualitative and quantitative data that comes in, because we find numbers don't tell the entire story, but telling a story gives a lot more information in terms of what's really at stake and the impact, really emphasizing what Rama just said.
Thank you, Christopher. The next question I would like to offer to Melanie, and it's from Laura Salisbury. It strikes me that leadership doesn't necessarily exist in a singularity, but as a shared value among group of people. Might you speak a little bit more about how the values of creative leadership embrace this?
Thank you, Ninella. Laura, that's an excellent question. That leadership doesn't exist in singularity. That does take some thinking. Let me just address that generally in leadership and then through creative leadership. leadership indeed doesn't exist in singularity, but that just means that it exists amongst. It can exist with, which is a ratio. So one leader to the ratio of 10 followers, one leader to the ratio of 100 followers. When you use the word amongst, you get the impact that you are leading amongst people. And you could still follow the old ratio leadership, one leader to the ratio of something. I'd like to rephrase that question or rephrase the word amongst to that leadership happens in relationship to, in relation. It is a relationship, and this is what creative leadership is about. Creative leadership, let me just tell you people, is not a comfortable experience. It requires you get out of yourself. You must get out of yourself. It requires specific training. It's the reason why I agreed with Rama that neuroscience can really work with creative leadership, because to stretch outside, empathy requires stretching outside of yourself. Creativity is a stretch. Clarity requires you to be mindful. These are not traits. They are not. You can value it, but to make them a value, where they actually become a personality trait, they become a trait that, let's just call it a default trait, requires training. So if creativity, clarity, and empathy seem like lovely new world concepts, I have to tell you, break the news to you, that it will require scratch. And Laura, to directly answer your question, true leadership, and this is why I am on the creative leadership team, because I believe that true leadership is the ratio of equality amongst everybody. And it starts with, as the creative leadership model is, it starts with self, with the self. I hope that answers, at least partly answers your question.
Thank you, Melanie. The next question is from Lucy, and I would like to offer that to Irene and Rama. Lucy says, as a disabled woman working in construction, leadership has always been something unexpected of someone like me. This is evident from the lack of diversity in teams I have worked with, a culture of construction being a man's industry, and the direct discrimination I have experienced during my career. What do you think is the most important thing that can be done to enable more marginalized people into these arenas?
You want me to go first?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I think one of the major issues is that I feel that most people want to address the issue of disability, but they are not realizing that for you to address the issue of disability, you have to have employees with disability within your organizations. And that will enable you to be able to serve them, but also to serve customers with disabilities. Because you can say you're developing products of people with disabilities, but if you don't have them in your institutions, you don't know who they are. If you don't have them as your customers speaking to you and telling you what their needs are, then you cannot design anything for them. And for me, I feel it for you, especially because you're a woman, so that's another layer of challenges in leadership. But I think you have to keep pushing, but I think it would be most critical for organizations to really embrace the idea of having people with disabilities in employment, because I do believe that's where you can really start addressing the issues of people with disabilities or embracing them. Thank you.
Thank you, Irene. Rama?
So I was very excited about this question, Lucy, because I've been thinking about this for many years, but particularly in the last week. As part of our creative leadership research, you know, we found some surprising things. Who would have thought that if you have an ability diverse company, it's better. Gender diverse, it's better. And age diverse, it's better. And race diverse, better. If you combine all of those things, it's better. You're more likely to survive challenges and changes. And the proof is out there, both qualitative and quantitative. The last part of your question, and this is the bit that sort of really got me, is what can we do? And there's lots of things. I think, you know, Irene's point is a hugely, hugely powerful one. And actually a friend of mine on LinkedIn offered another in this last week. So he wrote saying he was offered the presidency of a really well-known design and advertising group, and he refused it because he looks like a certain type of individual in terms of his gender, his color, and his age that has been offered this type of role in the past. So he politely but publicly stepped back from it in order to encourage them to put someone else that was more diverse. And I actually shed a tear when I saw that, because there's 7.6 billion of us on this gorgeous little planet. If people who are in that position or offered that position just gave space to the rest of us, that would be an amazing thing. That would be an enabler. So I want to salute my friend Ben, who wrote that, and such a quiet empath. He didn't shout about it. He just shared it in a post.
Thank you, Rama. There's a question I'd like to offer to Christopher. It's from James Krabby. Archbishop Callistus Ware wrote, "There is a thin line between affirming mystery and talking rubbish from the self, from salted self. We must not be afraid to affirm that mystery, which is at the heart of leadership, linking the three elements underlying creative leadership. But words are only one way to communicate. Music and theater are two more. How would you like to develop creative leadership or leadership using other modes of communication?"
What a neat question. As someone who's spent my life in the theater, making music, singing music, what it's shown to me is that when you do things in conjunction with people, my background is in classical music, and you would rehearse with 10, 20, 100 people, and you would do something together. And some of my most rewarding experiences was making music with other people. Yet it's not as sort of exciting as being a soloist in the middle of the stage. Doing things with people and doing things that's outside of the business environment, be it cooking. I've had some of our greatest experiences as well, the team cooking with each other or doing art. A few months ago, I guess it was December of last year, we actually went and had a graffiti party with our team. And we literally made graffiti and on the wall, completely legitimately, wrote out the word accessibility. And we all designed it, we all painted it ourselves, and we had some constraints. And we've never been closer than these times when we're not working together, but working with people who have a similar like mind, similar passion. So I think it is extremely important to do non-traditional things together. Sort of to Melanie's point, when you're working amongst people and in relationship to people, things really come together. It's that relationship, or these are the strings that bind us together. And this is how we communicate with each other, is through this relationship. If you don't know someone, you don't know what motivates them. You don't know what excites them. You don't know what scares them. And there's a question earlier in the list about working with, I hope it's okay if I bring in another question, about working at Google and being a commercial company, and is being commercial necessarily sort of at odds of doing things inclusive with accessibility? And the answer is no, because people are complex and they have multiple sides. You may have an obligation to make sure that you make money for your shareholders, but you're still a person who has relationships with people, and you can't separate one from the other. So Melanie's point really is resonating with me. It's relationships is what makes a leader. And different people can be leaders at different times. Rama said it's not always about the person, the old white guy standing at the front of the room. It's about the person having the right skills and the right message and it's like jazz. You give and take. One person takes it, and then another person takes it. And that's really what leadership is. It's the wisdom of the group.
Thank you, Christopher. This is a fantastic note for 5 o'clock. I'm a little bit conscious of time, but also we've seen a lot of good questions that we'd like to answer. So before we do that, in case anyone needs to leave, please don't stay with us. But if you must leave, this event is the final event for this week. And Rama would like to say a couple of words to everyone before we continue, and we can take 2 or 3 more questions.
Absolutely. We always feel that when you hit the leave button on Zoom, it's like a red instruction that just cuts everyone off. So we recognize some people will need to leave now, but the panelists have very kindly agreed to stay on for another 10 minutes to kind of mimic that post-conference, post-panel coffee conversations that happen. But I just wanted to say that the Design.Different week that we have here at the RCA, and you know, we will be sending out a magazine on it from the center. It wouldn't have happened without the values of empathy, clarity, and creativity. They've been 6 events that last year I would have been very nervous to do, but with the empathy of colleagues, the clarity that we need these approaches, and we need to build a community, and the creativity in putting it together really made this happen. We've had, I think, over 1,500 people attend our 6 events. We really feel there is a massive community of interest. And for the creative leaders of Leaders Circle, we don't want to hold it like this. We want it to be like this. We want you to be like that butterfly that landed in my hand in the greenhouse. So I just wanted to formally say that really 2 things. I see a lot of people who are attracted to this and looking at the questions have an empathic tendency. And it is really important to empaths, as empaths, that you inject a little joy into your everyday. Why? Because, you know, you're not required to set yourself on fire to keep other people warm. You can give of yourself, but don't give away yourself. And the reason we started with that conversation around my father is that that was a huge lesson for me, that you cannot see other people's tears through your own. And there's times when you need to regroup, you need to consolidate, and you need to have that self empathy. So words can carry a seed of change. Every word can carry a seed of change. And we have 3 words here for you. Empathy, clarity, and creativity. They've carried the seed of change for us. And we would love to hear how they have carried, may carry, and potentially will carry the seed of change for you. So please be in touch. We would love to hear and share in your wisdom. And do stay on if you want to for more discussion. And I'm going to direct more questions at Christopher and Irene and Melanie, because I realize I've done a lot of talking.
Thank you, Rama. Here's another good one. Let's start with Irene. How would you advise everybody to be creative leaders and influence world affairs when they do not have positional power? Is social media a chink in the armor of the structures?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I think it's more so get engaged and speak your truth. So if you understand what it takes, a good example is if you understand disability and the needs of people with disabilities, be very vocal. And whether it's at your job or any event that you attend or any social gathering, I think it's important to use your voice. And trust me, never underestimate your power as a human being. It doesn't matter whether you're the most executive person or you're at the low level. Everyone has some sort of power. So I would advise everyone to just use your inner power, use your voice. Many people won't hear you. Trust me, for 14 years, no one was listening to me. So it was a very lonely journey. But I had a very powerful team that sort of understood what our mission was, and they could see the bigger picture. And that's what happens. You create your own little circle that gets the message and you're able to move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Irene. Melanie, is there something you may add to this?
I really was thinking about the positional power. Don't let position define you. You know, it's a learned response. It's a socially adaptation response. Children don't, when they're growing up at the age of one or two, toddlers don't go, oh, well, my position is, last in the pecking order, so I'm not going to say, oh, no way. Children say, I want. This is how you learn. This is how the brain develops. This is how, so position, don't let position has no power. Don't be defined by positional power. Mm-hmm. It's the position you take in whatever position you're in that actually is the way forward. So, and social media, of course, these days, technology is there to help us if we want to use it in the right way. I just thought I'll say that.
Thank you, Melanie. Christopher, can I direct this next one at you? It's from Neil. Hello, thanks for all the talks, being great to hear. My question is, aside from having substantial patience, resilience, and learning heavily on empathy to communicate in the manner the other party would prefer, how can you inspire, excite, and get buy-in, both generally from people or cultures that are strongly weighted to analysis, risk aversion, and skepticism?
Thank you for the question, Neil. I think, to me, the answer is understand the relationship, build a relationship with the people that you're trying to work with. You can't convince someone something if you don't know what motivates them. Is it fear? Is it fear of missing out? Is it fear of competition? Is it risk? Are we going to get sued? Can they just be inspired? Understanding the people that you're trying to influence is really, really important. You're never going to be able to create a message that lands if you don't understand what motivates them. So I'd say start by getting to know the individual, get to know the culture, work with allies who believe in what you're trying to do, and co-create a message that will have the greatest ability to impact.
Thank you, Christopher. And I have one question from Rosalind, which I'd like to offer to the whole panel. This is such a wonderful dialogue. Thank you. You're all inspirational examples of the values you speak of. When was the last time you felt most alive? What were you doing and who were you with?
I'll go.
Thank you, Mel.
So when have I felt most alive? When was the last time this very forum that we're on, for example? I mean, people on this forum and through the questions are letting you, it's a privilege to be let into somebody's life. When they share their perceptions, when they share, you know, who they are. And every present moment is the best moment of your life. If you're listening, as Rama says, beyond the knowledge, if you're truly listening, if you're truly getting what this moment's about, then that is the most inspiring moment. For example, something that really brought so much of fun to my life in an instant was Christopher's artistic media graffiti on the wall. So my mind went off for a second and I had to really rein it in to bring it back to mindful presence, because I was looking at, as a scientist, oh wow, can you imagine getting a group of scientists, graffiti on the wall, COVID-related mental health issues from isolation, oh boy. You know, you can wear a gray suit, you can be a scientist, you can wear your lab coat and come to that event. And there is no doubt that just one person taking off on that, you know, writing something on the wall, and I'm serious about this, would actually incite mirror neurons. And the most self-confessed uncreative person will be able to have fun with that. And I think that in that space of fun is where a lot of creativity, clarity, you know, really starts to shape up. So, I mean, tell me that this this event isn't doing the same thing for other people. Thank you, Nanala.
Thank you, Melanie. Christopher?
Oh, that was just gesturing a mic drop. I don't know how anyone can respond after that. Since you're making me say something, I will say one thing. It is really about the interaction with people. I'm most alive when I'm engaged with people, doing my best to help them, because I've learned things, I have opportunities, and if I can help someone else do better, the sort of the wake of their life gets to impact more and more people.
Thank you. Irene?
So I feel most alive every time after a meditation session, which I do every day. And the reason is because I get some sort of peace and I'm more open to receiving from other people as compared to having any sort of resistance or worry or anything. So I feel most alive after a really good session of meditation.
Thank you, Irene. And Rama, last but not least.
So I'd actually replied to Rosalind saying the three values, they live almost, you know, they play a symphony every day. So right now is when I most feel alive, because I, you know, whatever I'm doing, whether it's staring at a butterfly or whether it's actually feeling the pain of my father's death, or whether it's feeling the delight of being with all of you. So I think, you know, it's moment by moment, and it's kind of right now. I just wanted to say that someone called Colin, one of our new colleagues leading the Design Age Institute, typed in something that I think is really rather beautiful. He said, "If knowledge is shouted and wisdom whispered, is empathy embraced?" And I really think empathy can be the embrace of a strong sun or a gentle moon and shades in between. It's that interplay. And that's where that the interplay of that is where I feel most alive.
Thank you, Rama. And thank you, Irene, Melanie, and Christopher. I think these are wonderful notes to end on. Thank you to the audience for listening, for your considered questions. If we haven't answered them here, please do reach out. Our doors are always open and we're always happy to collaborate, co-create and experiment. I wish you all a fantastic end of the week, restful, joyful and full of energy. Do join the Creative Leaders Circle and I look forward to hearing from you. Self.
Thank you, Nanala.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.